Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to Advent and to this worship service this morning. Some of us here have traveled really far to be here. Welcome, South African Belgium clan. And others have come from much closer. So this service will have a few kind of unusual quirks to it, surprises, because today is both the first Sunday of Advent. Fourth. Did I say first? Fourth. It ain't my language. The fourth Sunday, the last Sunday of Advent, and Christmas Eve. And I personally don't recall ever doing something with it or encountering something like this. So thank you to the Altar Guild, especially this Sunday, for their creativity and their problem-solving skills. And you will see this a little later. So for now, let us begin our worship service. And for those who haven't been worshiping with us the last few weeks, we have pondered one question in all of our services: how does a weary world rejoice? The weariness of the world doesn't need any explanation. I think you all know, feel the weight of what's going on around us in our own country and elsewhere. But how, in the midst, acknowledging that weariness, can we genuinely rejoice? So how does a weary world rejoice?
We
tell stories of what could be. We listen for God's word. We resist the temptation to give up or give in. We remember Mary's song. We gather for worship. We hope, and against all odds, we hope. Friends, this is the day that the Lord is still making. Let us worship our holy God together. And as this part of the service is still an Advent service, we begin with confession. Versions of the phrase, "Be not be afraid," are written in the Bible as many as 365 times, reminding us that each day anew God says, "Be not afraid." Over and over again, God tells us not to be afraid. As we now confess our sins to God, let us be honest with God about the mess of our lives, trusting that God does not rejoice in keeping score or punishing us. Instead, God wraps us in mercy and holds us in love. So be not afraid and join me in the prayer of confession. Loving Christ, Scripture tells us that you were born in a stable because there was no room in the inn. There was no room in the inn for a woman in need. No room in the inn for an innocent baby. Forgive us. We should have learned our lesson by now. But just as others turned their backs on you, we continue to turn our backs on one another. Teach us how to make room for one another. Teach us how to make room for you. Carve out space in our hearts to love us as you love. Guide us forward into a better future. With hope and honesty, we pray. Amen. Friends, the angels say, "Be not afraid." But they also say, "Unto us, unto you, a child is born." Christ is born for you. Christ walked this earth for you. Christ forgives you. That's what love does. It makes room. It offers grace. It learns your name. So repeat these words of hope after me. Unto us a child is born.
Unto us grace is given.
May this good news change the very fabric of our lives. Amen. And now let's sing together, and if you are able, please rise. Our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with all of you. How does a weary world practice joy?
By dancing and throwing birthday parties.
By hanging Christmas lights and holding sleepy babies. By singing loudly and looking for good news.
By telling the story of Jesus and showing up for the community.
There are millions of ways to practice joy. So today, we light the candle of joy as a reminder and a charge.
With God's help, may we bring joy into a weary world.
When confusion claims us, when we feel unable to do anything right, the Holy One invites us to be faithful. And we find joy. Amen. So could I have the Belgians come forward, please? Who wants this? And let's sing.
Let us pray together. Loving God, we have heard this story before. The story of a star in the sky and a baby who was laid in a manger. We have heard this story before, passed down in helpful whispers through the generations. So today, as we learn our hearts and ears closer to you, we ask that you would make room in our souls to hear this story again. Make room in us for all. Make room in us for wonder. Make room for heartache and compassion. Make room in our hearts for you. Pull us into your story with creations. that we might hear the truths in this ancient word as if it were the first time. For we know that you are still speaking, so speak to us again this night. We are listening. We are already making room. Amen.
Taken from the Holy Gospel according to Luke, chapter 2. In those days, a decree went out from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be registered. This was the first registration that was taken while Quirinius was governor of Syria. All went to their own towns to be registered. Joseph also went from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to the city of David called Bethlehem, because he was descended from the house and family of David. He went to be registered with Mary, to whom he was engaged and who was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for her to deliver the child. And she gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped him in a band of cloth and laid him in a manger, because there was no place in the guest room. Now in the same region, there were shepherds living in the fields, keeping watch over their flocks by night. Then an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for see, I am bringing you good news of great joy for all the people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign for you. You will find a child wrapped in bands of cloth and lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of heavenly hosts praising God and saying, "Throughout God's heaven and on earth
peace among those who have favor."
When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go now to Bethlehem and see this thing that has taken place, which the Lord has made known to us." So they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the child lying in the manger. When they saw this, they made known what had been told to them about this child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds told them. And Mary treasured all these words and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen, just as it had been told to them. The Gospel of the Lord.
Gentlefolk, welcome to my family's home. I am Elizabeth. My baby son, John, is asleep. He was born only last week and circumcised earlier today. My husband has gone into town. The house is quiet, and I have time to tell you a bit what happened in our lives. I start with who we are, our background, then I tell you about my marriage, about what happened to my husband in the temple 9 months ago, and about my young relative Mary. I'm sure you want to know about her. Oh, and this is my new shawl. Zechariah gave it to me today. I married right after I turned 13. That was 55 years ago. I married a member of my own tribe of Levi, Zechariah. That means that both he and I are descendants of Aaron, the brother of Moses. Zechariah was 17 and handsome. Early on in our marriage, Zechariah and I determined that integrity and faith are important to us. Like our ancestors, we live in the hill country of Judea in a beautiful village about 5 miles west of Jerusalem. I guess any marriage has its hurting points, its tender or sensitive issues. Ours was our failure to produce offspring. We prayed I fasted month after month, year after weary year. No child. Here in Israel, childlessness is considered a curse. I was... I was blamed. My neighbors talked about me first behind my back and then to my face. Over the years, my friendships dwindled. I was afraid Zechariah would divorce me and take a second wife. You probably know the story of Hannah. She longed for a child, and her husband Elkanah took a second wife in order to have children. Peninnah, the second wife, had many children and made Hannah's life miserable. The Lord heard Hannah's prayer, and she gave birth to Samuel. Zechariah never divorced me and never took another wife. For that, I am so grateful. Instead, he chose to share my blame, my shame. But we could not meet each other's eyes. For years, there was silence between us. Now I will tell you a bit about Zechariah. I call him an old moron. And he is. He has a bristly white beard. He always seems to have the last word. He always thinks he is right. Well, those are the ways he was. He's much different now. But I get ahead of myself. I've studied my husband for years and tried to please him. He wants his meals on time. And his priestly garments laundered just so. On the one hand, he is a scholar and a man of prayer. He loves the Lord, the God of Israel. Yet on the other hand, he is a man of facts. He trusts in facts. Well, in these last 9 months, he has come to realize that miracles are facts. Zechariah has changed, but I'll get to that in a moment. Now, let me tell you how our lives changed. Zechariah belongs to the priestly order of Abijah, one of the 24 shifts in the management of the temple. Each had a shift a week, twice a year. So he and I went to Jerusalem together. Once he got to the temple, the specific temple assignments were drawn by lots, as was the custom. Zechariah was chosen by lot to burn incense outside the Holy of Holies. This was the honor of a lifetime. While I was in the courtyard with the crowd, Zechariah was meticulously performing his duties. And later I learned an angel of the Lord appeared to him, standing at the right side of the altar of incense. Zechariah was startled and then afraid. The angel said to him, "Do not be afraid, Zechariah. Your prayer has been heard." Zechariah wondered, "What prayer?" Then the angel was specific. "Your wife, Elizabeth, will bear you a son, and you are to give him the name John." Zechariah gasped. The angel continued, "He will be a joy and delight to you, and many will rejoice because of his birth." Zechariah gasped again. The angel kept on, "He will be great in the sight of the Lord." Then the angel gave some requirements about how to raise the boy, John. The angel said that he is never to take wine or fermented drink. Zechariah's mouth was open, his eyes were big. I think the angel chuckled a bit at that point. The angel continued with this news about our son. He will be filled with the Holy Spirit even from his mother's womb. And I can attest to that he was. Then the angel concluded about the purpose of our son and the reaction of some people within Israel. Our son, the angel said, will bring back many of the people of Israel to the Lord their God. The news overwhelmed Zechariah. He paced back and forth in front of the altar of incense. The angel waited patiently. Eventually, Zechariah turned to the angel and said, "How can I be sure of this? I'm an old man, and my wife is well along in her years too." This is not something you say to an angel. I could have told that. Zechariah has since learned a hard lesson. The angel took offense and said this, "I am Gabriel. I stand in the presence of God, and I have been sent to speak to you or to tell you this good news." Then the angel decreed a punishment for Zechariah. "You will be silent and not able to speak until the day this happens, because you did not believe in my words, which will come true in proper time." Then the angel left. Zechariah tidied up the area around the altar and came out to see us worshipers. He was very dazed. He could not speak. He looked for me. I pushed forward in the crowd and came to him. He took my hand. Another priest pronounced the blessing. We all knew something profound had happened in the temple. We walked the distance back to our lodgings in Jerusalem. Zechariah was alternately crying, filled with emotion, trying to talk, remorseful, and skipping. I couldn't believe what I was seeing. My husband, over 70 years old, was skipping. I fed him dinner. He fell asleep with a smile on his face. His duties at the temple lasted a few more days. Everybody avoided him because he couldn't speak. We walked home from Jerusalem, and his confusion seemed to lift a bit once we got home. He brought out a writing tablet and wrote down the angel Gabriel's words. I rejoiced. We hugged, we kissed, we prayed together, we thanked the Lord. And then I became pregnant. I hid myself for 5 complete months. No one except Zechariah knew I was pregnant. Truly, my pregnancy is a miracle, an answer to our prayers. My shame is taken away. Truly, with God, nothing is impossible. On one day, in my 6th month, I was in my house, cooking and singing. Zechariah was out shopping for us. I don't know how he does that, given that he has no voice, but he somehow did. I heard my name called by a young woman's voice. I was startled. I turned around and saw my cousin, Mary. Mary is the daughter of Anna, my mother's sister. Mary is 14. I had heard that she was engaged to be married to Joseph, a carpenter in Nazareth. She called my name. And as soon as she did, the baby in my womb started leaping. What a commotion! I was being kicked violently. Yet, there were happy kicks. Then felt something entirely new. I was filled with the Holy Spirit. Then, in a very loud voice that surprised me, I turned to Mary and said, "Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the child you will bear." We looked at each other. I was amazed at what I had said, for I had no idea that she was pregnant. My baby was kicking energetically. Mary's mouth opened, my mouth opened. We reached for each other's hands. I continued to shout, "But why am I so favored that the mother of my Lord should come to me?" As soon as the sound of your greeting reached my ears, the baby in my womb was leaping for joy. We looked at each other in astonishment. It was really a meeting of four. We two and our babies. We hugged, we kissed, we shouted, we danced, we patted each other's stomachs. We hugged and kissed again, we praised the Lord. I don't know what made me do it, but I knelt before her. I, the older woman, the woman of the house, knelt before a young woman and my guest. Even though all that is against our culture, I would do it again and again. I looked up at her sweet face and said this prophetic word, "Blessed is she who has believed what the Lord had said to her, and it will be accomplished." Mary nodded. Mary understood. Mary reached out her hand and helped me up. Mary later confessed that my words greatly encouraged her, for I appeared to know what had happened to her. And what a joyful time Mary's visit was. She stayed with us almost 3 months. I believe we gave to her and she gave to us so much as well. First, we believed her. We believed she carried the Son of God in her womb. Second, we gave space to her to be, to ponder, to consider what to do, to praise God. Third, she could be herself around us. We gave her sanctuary. Zechariah encouraged her greatly. He unrolled the scroll of Isaiah, which we had at home. He pointed to some words, indicating that they were for Mary. Mary and I leaned down to read them. "Behold, the virgin will be with child and will give birth to a son and will call him Emmanuel." Mary is that virgin, the three of us believed. Later, Mary told us her story, how Gabriel had come to her and told her she had found favor with God. She would be with child and give birth to a son and to give him the name Jesus. He would be great and would be called the Son of the Most High. Like Zechariah, she paused to consider these words. She then asked a technical question. How would all this come to pass since she was a virgin? But unlike my own husband, she did not question what the angel told her. She said, "Behold, I am the Lord's servant. May it come to me as you have said." When Mary told us her story, Zechariah began to weep quietly. He then knelt and repented before God for his unbelief. Because he couldn't speak, we don't know what he said. Much later, he told me that he compared his own disbelief to the faith of this small young woman. Ever since that moment, Zechariah has been a changed man. He is kinder to me. The sense of humor has returned. He listens to me. He listens. He sees me with eyes of love and understanding. Mary left 2 weeks ago to walk back as part of a group to Nazareth. Mary's courage amazes me. She still must tell her fiancé that she is pregnant. Her pregnancy puts her in great danger. For according to our law, she could be stoned, strangled, or burned to death. Joseph is not the father of the child she carries. We pray that Joseph too believes her and marries her quickly. After Mary left, Zechariah and I began to sit outside in front of our home in the evening. I liked the cold stones in my back. I liked to sit, for the last days of my pregnancy were quite uncomfortable, I tell you. I'm 68. Zechariah would hold my hand and pat it kindly. I talked of our son, how great he would be. We truly have been surprised by joy. We have a baby at our age. Imagine that. We are smitten parents, astonished and full of joy. Now let me tell you what happened this morning, today. My son was born 8 days ago. Mine was a difficult pregnancy. I was sick. The birth was difficult. I'm 68 years old. Miracles may happen, but they take place in human bodies. According to the custom of our people, our son was circumcised today, named and dedicated to the Lord. All of our neighbors and relatives were with us. Zechariah gave me this shawl as a special gift. When it came time to name the child, everyone thought the child would be named Zechariah for his father. Zechariah ben Zechariah. I said, no. He is to be named John. There was a big fuss, for we have no relatives by that name. A writing tablet was brought for Zechariah to confirm what I had said. He wrote, his name is John. Immediately, his tongue was loosened and he could speak. He started shouting. He kissed me. He kissed John. He kissed the rabbi. He kissed all of our relatives. Even the ones he didn't like. I held up the baby. Soon John was being passed around and around. We shouted and praised God, but Zechariah shouted the loudest. He could speak again. Oh, the amazing joy. Then Zechariah started singing. Oh, that dear old morn. He was filled with the Holy Spirit. I could tell because I am too, and he started prophesying. He praised the Lord, the God of Israel, for redeeming his people and raising up a horn of salvation for us. He praised God for rescuing us from the hand of our enemies and enabling us to serve him with righteousness and holiness all our days. Then he tenderly took young John from my arms and cradled him. He spoke to the baby in this way, and you, my child, will be called prophet of the Most High. You will go on before the Lord to prepare a way for him. Well, after that, we hugged and kissed some more. Our guests and neighbors were filled with awe. John got cranky. And I took him and fed him and put him down to sleep. Oh, how I pray that joy will mark my son's life as it has done, as he has done for me. Well, what would I like you to know and to remember? Mary, of course, was the first to know that her unborn baby is the Son of God. But I, Elizabeth, I and the baby son within me, we're the second people to recognize that Mary's womb holds the Son of God. There will be others, many others, who will know Jesus as the Son of God. They will draw strength from him, and he will grant them hope, peace, and joy. I hope that you are among them. Do you hear what I hear? I hear John. He's awake and fussy. I must go to nurse the little prophet. Please excuse me. Please come again another time. Let's rise.
Amen.
I invite you to stand, if you are able, and let us respond to the good news of God's salvation by confessing our faith. We believe that hope can change the world. We believe that God uses ordinary people, like an unwed teenage mother, for extraordinary good. And we believe that each of these ordinary people can make a difference. We know that grief, fear, and suffering abound. We know that harder for us too. But we choose hope anyway. In the face of hardship, we hope together. We hope for a better world. This is our song. We believe. Help our unbelief. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. And please be seated.
Holy God, excuse me. Holy God, excuse me. Holy God, we have been waiting a long time for this night, for the joy and the quiet of Christmas Eve, for the sound of the angel chorus, for the old familiar songs. Our hearts are weary, longing for the peace and hope of this night. And now we are finally here. So today, we want to thank you for the things in our lives that spark joy. Thank you for the gift of family, recipes, and crowded tables. We thank you for families getting together this time, and those that are separate but different for different reasons. We thank you for the bells and the songs and the candles in the window. Thank you for the children who squeal with joy and the neighbors who drop off cookies. Thank you for every ounce of beauty that marks this season, for it makes it possible for us to join our voices with the angel chorus. Lord, in your mercy. Yet God, even in the face of all that joy, we still bring weary and worried hearts to you this day. because we know that too many have an empty seat at the table this year. We know that too many will celebrate Christmas from a hospital room. We know that too many have crunched numbers over and over again to see if they could afford a gift. We know that for far too many, the holidays are a reminder that the world is still not as it should be. Lord, in your mercy. With them, we join in Mary's song and remember what the world can be and should be. Today we bring to you our prayers of hope. We implore you to turn injustice on its head. Lift up the poor and the hungry. Comfort the sick and the aching. And we bring to you all those that's with special needs and all those that's mentioned in the bulletin. Tend the lonely and the lost, and then plant a fire in our hearts to do the same. Lord, in your mercy. For we trust that you are here. We trust that you are present with us as we hope and pray for a better world, a world in which your love reigns victorious. Amen. The joy of Christ be with you always. Let us share that peace and joy with a sign to each other. Peace to you. As usual, the offering plates are in the front, and as you come up for communion, you will put your offering in the plates that's in the front here. Thank you.
I wonder as I wander out under the sky.
My apologies. I've got that we had received two special prayer requests this morning. One for Stephen, prayers of thanksgiving for a successful heart transplant, and just recently, and for a wonderful recovery after the surgery. And then there's a special request for Gabriel McGee, who is not having a good time and is struggling with mental issues. Let's do the offering prayer. Let us pray together. Holy One, this is Advent season. We wait in joy. Joy for all you have given us. Receive these generous offerings. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also
lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is
indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ. In the wonder and mystery of the Word made flesh, you have opened the eyes of faith to a new and radiant vision of your glory, that, beholding the God made visible, we may be drawn to love the God whom we cannot see. And so, with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Thank you.
and the end, the giver of life. Blessed are you for the birth of creation. Blessed are you in the darkness and in the light. Blessed are you for your promise to your people. Blessed are you in the prophet's hopes and dreams. Blessed are you for Mary's openness to your will. Blessed are you for your son Jesus, the Word made flesh. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Again, after supper, Jesus took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." Let us together proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. With this bread and this cup, we remember your word dwelling among us, full of grace and truth. We remember our new birth in his death and resurrection. We look with hope for his coming. Come, Lord Jesus. Holy God, we long for your Spirit. Come among us. Bless this meal. May your word take flesh in us. Awaken your people. Fill us with your light. Bring the gift of peace on earth. Come, Holy Spirit. All praise and glory are yours, O Holy One of Israel. Word of God incarnate, power of the Most High, one God, now and forever. Amen. Let us continue this meal praying together the prayer Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Jesus was born into a world that loves to turn people away. A world with shut doors and closed hearts. A world that loves to say there is no room for you. Friends, that will not happen to you here, because Jesus spent his life making room. He made room for tax collectors and children. He made room for 5,000 people to sit down and eat together. He made room for Samaritan women, Jews, and Gentiles. He made room for the sick, the outcast, for the unclean. Jesus was always pulling up a seat, saving space, making room for people. And he has made room for you and me. So come to this table. Come with your faith and your doubt. Come with your questions and your hopes. Come with your grief and your love. Just come, because there is room for you here. This is Christ's table. All are welcome to it. And so that each and everyone can receive safely, there are gluten-free wafers available upon request, and the light-colored liquid in the center cups is grape juice. So let the ushers guide you. We start on this side, and they will gradually guide everyone towards the altar in that direction. So come, for all is now ready. And if you, for some... Thank you. Please rise if you're able. May the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace.
Let us pray together. God of angel choruses and teenage mothers, we thank you for being present here with us. We thank you on this table, your table. We remember the ways that you always make room for us. You are always pulling up chairs, welcoming the children, the tax collectors, and the outcasts. At your dinner party, no one gets turned away. You help us to carry that inclusive spirit into the rest of our lives, like we know that we love, like that is what turns weariness into joy. With the grateful hearts we pray. Amen.
Have a seat for a moment. So most of the announcements are thank yous. I think my first thank you goes to Nurlana for going backward and forward and backward and forward. Thank you for keeping a calm spirit and following along and guiding us. Thank you so much. Next, the Altar Guild. Wasn't that fabulous the way they did this? Then to all the musicians, the choir, there will be more musicians tonight. Thank you. To the techies back there, all of them, to Dave for helping with the flow of the service and leading the choir and the musicians. Thank you. So, and tonight there is another Christmas service, and that is an Christmas-only service. Different songs, more carols, a different sermon, not the same. So if you want to experience more of the Christmas joy, if you want to see the candles in your hands in the darkness and the decor in the narthex in the darkness, come tonight, join us at 7 o'clock. So I think that is, we are, daylight and all, are going to share the light of Christ and have turned this into a candlelight service, a daytime candlelight service. So, let me take the light from this beautiful pink candle. If I can. Okay. And can you reach that? Otherwise not. I can get it down. Yeah. Yay for tall assisting ministers. And remember just the safety announcement. Your candle, the lit candle is straight, the other ones get bent towards the light, and let's share the light of Christ.
Thank you.
on this day and always. May you be filled with the wonder of Mary, the obedience of Joseph, the joy of the angels, the eagerness of the shepherds, and the determination of the Magi, and the peace of the Christ child. Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever. And Merry Christmas to you.
Go in peace. Christ is born.
Thanks be to God.